Indeed, the Webster study, arguably the most rigorous of the three, only investigated the impact of mask on non-scrubbed members of the surgical team. There is uncertainty over whether the findings of some of these studies are applicable to contemporary surgical practice. Based upon the findings of this review, National Institute for Health and Care Excellence guidelines state that there is limited evidence concerning the use of non-sterile theater wear such as surgical masks when trying to minimize the risk of surgical site infection, although there was an overall consensus that wearing non-sterile theater wear is important in maintaining theater discipline. This latter statement seems to be a rather vague and likely unfounded assertion which implies a correlation between dress code, staff discipline, and thereby patient safety outcomes. This may reflect a reluctance among the medical profession to deviate from embedded tradition as reflected in Leland and McCloy's questionnaire study. 1. Alternatively, it may reflect a prevailing intuition that surgical masks ought to protect against surgical site infections. Unfortunately, publicly available information regarding the financial costs of face mask usage on the National Health Service is lacking. However, as part of the Freedom of Information publication scheme, the data are available for the West Hertfordshire Hospitals NHS Trust, which purchased 44,482 single-use face masks in 2012.14. During this year, the West Hertfordshire Hospitals NHS Trust performed a total of 63,250 operative procedures or interventions. 15. Extrapolation to the 10,594,814 total operative procedures and interventions carried out across NHS England during the same period. 15 would equate to an annual procurement of almost 7.5 million single-use masks across hospitals in England. The NHS Atlas of Procurement lists the per-unit expenditure of surgical face masks to be between 34 pence to £1.22, depending on trust and supplier. 16. This suggests that annual NHS England expenditure on face masks lies somewhere in the region of £2.5 to £9.1 million. Hospital-acquired infections, of which surgical site infections are a subset, are a major problem for all health systems. Media coverage, in recent times, has heightened public awareness of their associated morbidity and mortality. Their socio-economic impact is also substantial. 17. And it is estimated that iatrogenic infection increases the duration of average hospital stay by a factor of 2.5 while incurring almost three times the monetary cost of uninfected patients. Across the whole of the United Kingdom, it is estimated that annually hospital-acquired infections cost the National Health Service almost £1 billion in excess expenditure and a loss of 3.6 million bed days. Personal costs for the patients are also affected as their return to normal daily activity and employment are delayed. Given the uncertainty in effectiveness of face masks in preventing surgical site infection, it is impossible to perform a cost-to-benefit analysis on mask usage. It is clear, however, that the National Health Service expenditure on face masks is a mere fraction of the costs incurred due to hospital-acquired infections. Protection of the surgeon. An increasingly prevalent belief, in favor of mask usage, is the idea that they also confer some degree of protection to the operating staff from patient-derived infectious material. 18. Most obviously, they can act as a physical barrier against blood and bodily fluid splashes during surgery. One prospective study revealed that face masks prevented blood/bodily fluid splashes that would have otherwise contaminated the surgeon's face in 24% of procedures. 19. The incidence of blood/bodily fluid splashes varies substantially between settings and between individuals. The risk is modified by the role of surgical staff. Lead surgeons are at higher risk than first assistants, who in turn have a higher risk than scrub nurses, by surgical specialty as well as by surgical technique. 19.20. The frequency of blood/bodily fluid splashed has been reported to be as high as 62.5% in lead surgeons performing cesarean section. 20. Despite clear evidence that face masks act to protect the theater staff from macroscopic facial contamination, there are studies to suggest that they fail to protect surgeons from potentially hazardous submicrometric contaminants. 21. This corresponds roughly to the size range of infectious bacteria, while viruses are even smaller. Therefore, the protection that masks confer in the form of macroscopic facial contamination may not necessarily extend towards any microscopic infectious agents present within that contamination. Proponents of the surgical face mask may argue that even if they fail to completely negate the risks of infection, they are likely to reduce exposure in a dose-dependent manner. While this field has not been extensively investigated, preliminary work suggests that face masks fail to confer any degree of protection from infection due to streptococcal and staphylococcal bacterial species 22 or hepatitis B virus. 23. Furthermore, a face mask splash may promote a false sense of security, as surgeons may be less likely to report these as an occupational exposure to bodily fluid compared to frank facial contamination. Tying things together in surgery, there are many aspects of current clinical practice that do not necessarily have an established evidence base. Indeed, it is permissible to bypass the evidence ladder when an intervention is so convincing that it is possible to discern its effect signal from noise by observation alone. 24. In such circumstances, interventions have a very clear mechanistic cause and effect relationship. Historically, it may have been thought that surgical masks fulfilled such criteria. This would explain why published literature examining surgical mask effectiveness has been lacking despite their ubiquitous nature within the surgical profession. What literature that is available on the subject tends to be dated with poorly explained methodology. There is also uncertainty over whether the results of such studies can be extrapolated to current surgical practice given the advent of new antiseptic techniques since they were completed. The evidence base investigating the effects of face mask usage on patient-based outcomes is, in general, more extensive than that of surgeon-centered outcomes. Face masks do have a clear role in maintaining the social cleanliness of surgical staff, but evidence is lacking to suggest that they confer protection from infection either to patients or to the surgeons that wear them. Given that there is no evidence that they cause any harm either, proponents would rather err on the side of caution and encourage their continued use, stressing that there is no room for complacency when it comes to ensuring patient safety. 25. This opinion is similarly echoed by the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence guidelines, which assert that mask usage contributes towards maintaining theater discipline. Another unavoidable aspect of this debate is that of public perception. In the public psyche, face masks have become so strongly associated with safe and proper surgical practice that their disposal could cause unnecessary patient distress. Indeed, the response on various medical forums following Mr. Ahmed's decision not to wear a mask during his broadcasted surgeries would reflect the prevalence of such a belief among the public. It is clear that more studies are required before any absolute conclusions can be drawn regarding the effectiveness or, indeed, ineffectiveness of surgical masks. The published literature does suggest that it may be reasonable to further examine the need for masks in contemporary surgical practice given the interests of comfort, budget constraints, and potential ease of communication, although any such study would undoubtedly have to be large and well controlled to prove causality given the low event frequency of surgical site infections. It is possible, if not probable, that if surgical face masks were to be introduced today, without the historical impetus currently associated with their use, the experimental evidence would not be sufficiently compelling to incorporate face masks into surgical practice. However, when current surgical practice is the culmination of layer upon layer of precautions in the hope of preventing surgical site infection, do we dare to experiment with their omission to see if they have any tangible consequence on morbidity and mortality? A randomized controlled trial investigating the uncertainty surrounding prophylactic antibiotic use in clean coronary artery surgery turned out to be catastrophic. The study had to be terminated early for ethical reasons due to an unacceptable increase in postoperative infection in the placebo cohort. 26. Perhaps an annual expenditure of a few million pounds in a healthcare budget of almost £100 billion is a small price to pay for an intervention of unknown but potentially dramatic effectiveness. It is important not to construe an absence of evidence for effectiveness with evidence for the absence of effectiveness. While there is a lack of evidence supporting the effectiveness of face masks, there is similarly a lack of evidence supporting their ineffectiveness. With the information currently available, it would be imprudent to recommend the removal of face masks from surgery. Instead, in the medical field where common practice can so easily become dogma, it is necessary to recognize the constant need to maintain a healthy skepticism towards established beliefs and to periodically re-evaluate and critically assess their scientific merit.